if I happen to trust that person and I respect the person, I would pick it up. But if it's just a casual remark, it doesn't matter, because at the end of the day, I'll see what's the value. Can I use the additional 50,000 rupees that I have in my wallet for something else when I can afford to live my life with a Windows laptop? So that's the difference there. So at the end of the day, it's a value equation that brings in new customers. But once they come in, then it's that service that transforms their whole attitude to how they want to look at other products in the marketplace.
From a brand growth point of view, Balaji, one of course is to, for a brand to grow, if you go back to basics, is to acquire new customers. And the second, of course, increase the consumption of existing customers. So service, of course, plays an important role. You know, as you're correctly saying, if I have confidence, if something goes wrong, the company's got my back, I'll obviously start using that thing more. But any other point, especially in the financial service industry in India right now, you know, people have multiple wallets, multiple cards, you know, multiple bank accounts. So from that perspective, any specific points in terms of how can someone think about increasing the consumption of the brand?
So I think, so the consumption is more about, at this stage, it's become more of a offer war, because in India, it's become like, hey, this wallet offers me 15% on the same purchase. And people are, you know, today, in a very mobile savvy environment where there are, like, let's say 400, 450 million smartphone users, and everyone is connected, or the ones who have access to these kind of products are all on the phone and all on smartphones. I think that it's very easy for them to go and download an app or sign up for a new product, etc.
Right.
If they know that there is this financial services provider offering 15% on Big Billion Day at a Flipkart, they did it last year and they may probably do it this year. So might as well pick up a product that will help me get to that 15% purchase, right? So I think that in that environment, you know, when it's all hunky-dory, people will go and sign up. It's only when you start thinking of service always like the first line of defense. Right? Till you get into a problem, you don't think of service at all. You only think of, hey, offers, right? It's like, I want to watch the cricket match. I want to pick up the cheapest television, flat screen television that's available, that comes as a deal. So you will go and pick it up because you're saying that, hey, there is this vendor who's given me a 60-inch screen at only 50,000 bucks, whereas one of the best brands is like at a 1 lakh 20, 1 lakh 25. So at that point in time, you will take a call and say, hey, this is coming at an offer, it's coming at a steal, let me go on. But what happens is, if something goes wrong with the television, or how often it goes wrong, is when you start wondering, was that a right decision that you made? Right. So I think that as consumers, I would say that a lot of decisions are driven very rationally at this stage, especially with a lot of compare and contrast and companies finding an easy medium to communicate via the phone. I think that it's a very tough game for every brand marketer here. Right. But the fact is, the core cannot be forgotten. If I can afford to put better offers out there, I will have to, if I have to compete in the marketplace.
So in such a marketplace, Balaji, how does, if suppose, you know, I'm a startup, for example, or even an established company, and I am thinking about getting rid of this sort of competition, which only works on offers and, you know, works on discounting right now, and I want to, for example, create a more premium positioning for a brand or a premium brand. Any thoughts on, you know, is it something which is even feasible today? Or is it something that, what kind of, if it is feasible, what kind of efforts that brand should put in?
I think that where you get the biggest bang for your buck is in the premium space. People are very discerning about what they want. People have clear ideas in terms of, or are very sure about what they seek in certain products and certain brands, right? It's not that, like, for example, a person who says, I want to drive a BMW 3 Series is not someone who will go and say, you know, yes, I have the money, but I am a value conscious consumer, so let me go and pick up a 5 lakh rupee car because I'm going from point A to point B. Right? People are very discerning. If he wants a 3 Series, he's going to stick in a 3 Series, or he's going to find a comparable product in the in Audi or a Mercedes-Benz that better suits his. He's not going to compromise and go for a a car that will just get him from point A to point B.
Right.
So I think that there is definitely value in the space, and that is where I think that brand building is definitely possible. I think a lot of it can come with power of association, in terms of who's a part of your program, who are you associated with, how are you going after the customers,
mm-hmm.
are you able to bring in the right partners, the right programs to the table that
mm-hmm.
conveys premiumness,
okay.
Right? And whether it's from a targeting perspective, you know, there are a lot of clear channels through which you can target these people. There are clear targeting methodologies that are available where you can target people. There are good partnerships who can take you along for going after this customer segment. There are people who will find win-win relationships with the brand if you think you have the right product set to be able to go after this customer group. So all of this become a part of the overall brand that you want to communicate to this customer group. Right. I think that the question is, how do you discern yourself to become that brand which conveys premiumness?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have the right product set that will provide value, both tangible and intangible, for the customer?
And that premiumness cannot just come from, say, just brand communication. The entire experience has to have a sort of wrapper of premiumness.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a 360 piece of it, right? If even though I may shout from the rooftop saying this is premium,
mm-hmm.
unless you're able to bring in the right partners, right value proposition, right products to the table, and the right tangible and intangible assets that will communicate it, it is not going to get you the results that you want.
Okay.
And it's a long haul. It's not easy one. Can let's say someone who's doing a startup now build a brand that is equivalent to that of a Mercedes-Benz or a American Express Black Card overnight? I'm saying that it's not. It's a journey. All of these brands have spent a lot of time and resources and efforts and created the
right.
whole essence around the brand.
Right.
So whether it can be done overnight, I have not come across any brand that was created overnight and it signifies premiumness.
Right.
The way some of these old premium brands have established.
It's a journey, you're saying. So, just changing gears, Balaji, now move. So, there is a lot of chatter about data, you know, it's like data analysis, data scientist, big data, small data, you know, all sort of things are being talked about. From a financial services brand perspective, the company has a lot of data at its disposal, you know, a lot of data that is there when you sign up, there are lots of consumption habits and everything which get sort of recorded in the system by default. So, how important it is for a financial company from a data analysis point of view, and what are some of the use cases that you have seen that, you know, which has helped the company in giving a better product or a better service to the customer?
So going back, I think I have an example to share. About 6-7 years back, I attended a breakfast meeting with one of the product directors of Watson, IBM.
Mm-hmm.
There are a group of about 10 odd people who attended this breakfast. And he said that, you know, this is going back to 2011, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, you know, in the room, we were all these like 35, 40 year olds who were there. He said that you guys are all worried about your privacy.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, you probably, before you head off to sleep, you clear your cookies and sleep, or you don't put anything out there in social media posts. But there's a whole generation that's waking up to Instagram posts that are like putting pictures of the coffee, talking about the day. There are on an average like 12 posts that they will put out there,
right.
Telling everything, every emotion, every aspect of their life on the internet.
Mm.
So imagine that today when you go to a website like Amazon, you'll have to browse through the categories and you will have to look at what you want.
Right.
And maybe if you don't clear your cookies, next time it'll give you other recommendations which are similar to what you were looking for, or
right.
people like you have liked this.
Right.
So that's how a site like Amazon gets its cues. But with this generation that is already online and that is like that lives on, they have a digital avatar to their physical avatar. Imagine that an Amazon, you come there and it's going to put something that's irrelevant to that audience, people will not come to the site again.
Right.
Because the attitude of the 20-year-old will be like, hey, I have so much data that I put out about myself, why can't you give me something that meets my criteria? I don't have time to go around searching for it.
Right.
You should already know that I have put in my Instagram post or I put it on my Twitter account that I am looking for a new pair of shoes. So why am I not seeing a pair of shoes? Because my digital identity is pretty much out there.
Right.
So I think that that is a generation that is much more open to what data out, is there, and are looking for more personalized web infrastructure as against the generic worldwide web that we all know about.
Yeah.
Right? They are saying that I have my identity, now wherever I go, it will curate everything that is unique to me. My news posts are on the topics that I want to look at, or when I visit a shopping site, it already knows what I'm looking for. And you know, if you look at all of the Alexas of the world today, or some of the innovation that's happening in Amazon, a lot of it is to do with personalization,
right,
where I don't even have to go to a website. I press a button and it automatically goes into my Amazon account and orders for replacement shop washing powder or more beards or anything else, right? So I don't have to go through the necessary process of actually logging to a website, looking at the products and ordering. It knows my choice of beer, it knows my choice of shopping, washing powder, it orders.
You can even recommend, you know, probably your out of washing powder now or out of beer now, you know, depending upon when you last ordered. So that those are
yeah,
that have
yeah. So I think that it is getting to be a more personalized world. And how is that all happening? That's all happening because there's a lot of data on your physical persona that you that your digital persona is creating for you.
Correct.
And organizations are only becoming more savvier to move towards that population that is coming up, which wants instant gratification, instant suggestions, instant ability to buy, than going through the traditional approach of browsing, searching, because they don't have time.
Right.
Right. I would rather use that extra minute to put a new post about myself rather than me going and looking up the website to buy something.
Right.
So I think that data is becoming critical for all organizations. But, you know, as Yoda says, along with it comes a lot of responsibility. So you have a lot of power in organization is getting a lot of power because they know a lot about the customers, but there is a lot of responsibility. We've seen recent examples of data leakages and all that. I think that so organizations have to be very careful. It has to be a permission-based approach because you can't assume that all the data that you're creating, your customer is giving permission to use it.
Right.
So I think that a more rational approach is, yes, you can churn, but seek a permission before you start using the data for things that the customer, it will help the customer's life per se. And I don't think people will have any issues if you're going to make their life easier, like a way that an Alexa does today.
Right.
People are open to it, but if you don't inform them, and there are a lot of YouTube videos going around which shows about how your phone is always listening to you because the search ads then end up being what you're talking about. Those are like, that scares the people because you've not asked permission. If you're looking for
right.
stuff, you ask me, if you're listening to me, ask me for permission before you listen to me.
Right?
That, if you think that, if I feel that you're going to add value to my life, I will give you permission.
Right.
If I feel that my data is secure, I'll give you permission. So I think that data is here to stay. It's not going anywhere. Approaches are going to change.
Right.
Privacy concerns are going to raise.
Right.
Permissions are going to be sought.
Right.
What you assume is always can be doable will not be the norm.
Right.
You know that there's a lot of regulation, GDPR regulations in Europe or all of that that's happening there. And even India has woken up to the fact that privacy is a critical component, as seen in the recent Supreme Court discussions on Aadhaar and mini biometrics and all of that, right?
Right.
So I think that definitely adds value because I can basis behaviors that we see of card members, ideally I should provide the card members more personalized offers, right? Or I should provide my customers more personalized offers. So that's the perspective here.
That's right. I think, as you've correctly said, essentially also do with permission. You should seek my permission before you use it for anything beyond what I have sort of signed up for.
Yeah.
Moving towards more to the other side of, you know, something which you have been doing for a while now is digital marketing, you know, so digital marketing and product management, so to say. So you've worked in the US, you've worked in India in that field. So my first question to you on digital marketing specifically is that how do you compare these two markets from the sheer acceptance of digital technology in marketing? You know, are they ahead of the curve, are they ahead of the curve, or they are two different curves in that sense?
I think that, so US has been the center of innovation at a lot of front end digital marketing, whether it was building data management platforms or whether it's about digital ad targeting, whether it's the ubiquitous cookie that we always talk about that follows you everywhere you go. All of those developments have happened in the US, and therefore it's rightfully so that they are ahead of the curve when it comes to capabilities. But from an adoption perspective, over the last 4 years, 5 years, I've seen that, you know, with the advent of e-commerce companies, they have replicated and innovated on some of those capabilities that have existed out in the West, right? So the speed at which we have adopted to some of those capabilities has been like, has been an eye-opener for me, right? I have built, I implemented DMPs back in 2012, and when I moved to India in 2013-2014, none of that kind of came into play. Even 2015 was the early discussions with partners on DMPs, etc. But by 2017 end, almost lot of the big companies already have implemented DMPs and are like utilizing it. So what did not exist to where companies are today, I think that's like the speed at which they are adopting to new capabilities and technologies to make marketing effective is like amazing.
Right.
So that's one data point. The second data point is, I think that when I was in the US, I was more sure about the data that was coming into me for marketing purposes. I think that I am still, in India, I am still very iffy about when someone says I have this data with these kind of characteristics, I am still very iffy about it. I have not been able to verify the veracity of when people claim that, hey, here are all these premium card owners. One is, where is the data coming from? How are you able to verify the veracity of the information? Is it true? Is it not? It's a black box, right? So that's where I am a little iffy in terms of that. But I think that over a period of time, I think that once people start monetizing information, I think that that should be something that should also be a no-brainer. So that those are the two big differences. Whereas in the US, when we speak to vendors, they'll clearly draw out the entire roadmap of how the data has traveled and where it came from, how are they building these characteristics on that particular cookie. So there's a lot of description and details that are there, because you know the rules and regulations around all of that is much more clearer. Here it's very gray space area. So you know, so therefore, as a marketer, I am one very careful, having worked in the US. Second is, for me, efficiency is also how good is it. So that's where my head is at this point in time.
The first point which you said was about the speed of adoption of digital technology in India by leading companies and in general by the brand leaders. One of the things which is more like a personal observation is that many companies are still using digital as more a tool of brand awareness than a tool to sort of actual drive sales an experience with the product or the brand. Any views on that, or do you think you've seen a different sort of
So I have been a performance marketer for the last 5 years. Back in the US, I used to focus on digital user experience and building the conversion journey, right? Once a person hits a website, then what are the kind of journeys I can present to them, and how do I get them to the right product, right offer, all of those kind of things. Here in India, I've been more of a performance marketer, which is how do I, yes, I have done a few brand campaigns, etc. But I think that the core goal that I needed to solve for is performance marketing. And I think that digital lends to itself very well. Gone are the days where I send a direct mail and track response rate, open are people opening. I think that that whole ecosystem of direct mail has moved to digital now. Whether I target a person through Facebook or LinkedIn or social media platforms, or whether I target a person on some of the affiliates or through email or through display media on their favorite website, I think that there is clear attribution and clear mechanics to measure performance and attribution. So I think that digital lends itself to be a performance marketing shop. At the same time, I think that it is also a good reach mechanism also. If my core functionality is to drive reach, I am saying that yes, I can drive reach to the right audience who I want to get to through digital with less of spillovers. Unlike a TV, here it I can get a little more targeted in terms of who I want to.
Measurement also.
Yeah, and so I am able to do a pre-post brand salience and other brand attribute measurements through these campaigns, as against going through traditional TV and then doing a research pre and post to understand, hey, did this brand campaign have an impact? So that's something that we can easily and instantly measure. So I think that having been, I think that my background has been more in the analytics and, you know, whether it's Pilani or post that, and whether it's been my past 19 years of experience, I think the brain is more of a nerd in a marketing wheel. So there is always, there has to be numbers to the story. So therefore, I think internet excites me because I'm able to see results instantly as against waiting over a period of time and then asking a few people how the campaign perform and then attributing the performance of the campaign to the 100 people I may have interviewed or let's say 1,000 people I may have done a survey to, instead as against I actually am experiencing in real time on how many people are clicking it, how many people are applying, all of those things lends itself well.
You had a hard stop at 10:30, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Couple of last questions, that okay?
Yeah, yeah, that's fine. Balaji? Hello? Sorry, go ahead.
So, just a couple of last questions. So, one question was on the nature of digital, you know, communication these days. So, there are, I would say, two schools of thought in that sense. One is talking about, let's do focused campaigns, targeted campaigns, but let's do campaigns which have measurable end outcome and all. There is another school of thought which is talking more about campaigns are fine, but let's have an always on content, you know. Let's always be there, present in the mind of the customer. Let's not talk about campaigns. Let's talk about a more content-based strategy towards acquiring customers, right? So any views on or any views on that?
So I think that once again.
Sure.
Balaji? Yeah, Ashwini, how are you?
Hi, very good. Quick question.
Yeah.
So, when we say we will give one primary card and we could give them two or three or four, whatever number of associate cards.
Yeah.
So, the associate cards are also going to be the metal cards?
Associate cards will also be metal cards. I'll just confirm that. I think it is.
Yeah,
it is. Okay, okay.
Just
well.
Let me know.
Okay,
yeah?
Okay. Thanks. So, so I think that content is the way to go. Always on has got to be there. I think that you know, brand campaigns, depending on, are always going to happen in bursts, right? Unless you are one of those packaged good or FMCG companies which always have to be on for driving buying behaviors. But if you look at financial services brands, you will come in some periods, you may go down in some periods because you don't have an always on brand presence like a FMCG does, right? So in those cases, I think financial services marketers have to think about how do I ensure that there is constant presence of the brand, there is constant presence of the brand in the marketplace, and that's where content marketing comes into play. I think that it is essential for every brand to ensure that there is a content presence in the marketplace, speaking to its existing customers as well as prospects out in the market.
Got it.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Just last question.
Sure. So, one last question, Balaji, you know, which is not to do with the marketing side of it, but you know, if Balaji as a person has to look at inspiration for or information on branding or marketing, so where is it that you go? Where is that you reach out?
So, usually, I, you know, my data consumption is more around Mashable, TechCrunch, where, you know, what I've done is I've added it to my, I'm following these companies on LinkedIn as well as Facebook. So, and these are two sites I visit on a regular basis. So, I think that the content automatically projects itself and keeps me updated on trends. So, it's probably, my attention span is 30, 40 seconds. So, I quickly go and read an article whenever I find the time. So, that's a space that I constantly look at. And of course, any other articles that may pop up here and there, or recommended by some of the people I follow on LinkedIn or Facebook,
or the cookie that is following you.
Yeah.
Great, great. Thanks, Balaji. It was a pleasure having you on.
Pleasure meeting you too, man. Thank you very much for having me over. We'll connect up soon.